this video is for you if you have hesitations about which list to choose, if you're wondering why there's so many contradictions. We're gonna figure it out. Hi, my name is Sarah, and welcome to Low-Sal-Life. Today we're talking about which list to choose when you get started on a low-salicylate diet. For me, I picked a list off of the internet, and it will be on one of the top lists that Google returns, and we'll talk about that later, which includes some foods like Brussels sprouts, which is a little bit on the controversial side. I kept having reactions for several months, and it wasn't until I realized that maybe Brussels sprouts really aren't low, and maybe I should check my lists before I realized that I shouldn't eat Brussels sprouts. And that included using vanilla and lemon and lime and all sorts of other fruits and garlic. Maybe you're 3 months in and you've been eating nothing but cabbage and meat, and you want to find out if there's other foods you can eat, but you've seen contradictions in the lists. I've also done that. I went mostly carnivore for about 3 or 4 months, which was great, but I wanted to eat other foods. And so I had to do a little bit of research to figure out what I was able to eat. If you go to my website, lowsallife.com, there's a tab called Food and Product List. And on there, I ended up going through two really important articles. And I've also added other articles too. But these two articles right here, you can tell that I've marked them up and thoroughly examined them. There are lots of different types of research. I mentioned this in my former video, but these are original research, which means that people actually did science experiments. They took food, they processed it a certain way, and then they tested the salicylic acid in each food. The first study is Swain et al. It's Anne Swain, they're in Australia. It was done in 1985, and they tested 333 foods. The second study that I'm going to talk about is Malachar et al. In 2017, and they tested 112 foods. They are also in Australia. Between the two, Malachar retested quite a few of Swain's fruits and vegetables, and it is really revealing to us either food has changed over 35 years or so, or there's a lot of variation in foods. And so today we're going to talk a little bit about the variation and why it's so frustrating for us to have a sensitivity to a chemical, want to eat these foods, and to have so much variation. So we're going to talk a little bit about it. I don't know if I mentioned, but I have a degree in biology and I mostly focus in botany. So I am a total plant nerd, and I realize that there is quite a bit of irony to being very allergic to plants and wanting to study them. But it works out for you guys in this channel, because I'm willing to dive in pretty deep when it comes to plants. So let's get started. If you go to my website, lowsallife.com, and click on the food and products list, what I've done is taken every single food listed in these research articles and broken them down with the actual quantifiable amounts that these two studies came up with, and included their dates. So you can make your own educated decision and decide whether or not the risk is enough for you to want to try the foods. For example, chayote has 0.10 milligrams of salicylates per kilogram, and that was tested in 1985 by Swain et al. What I don't know is if this food has ever been tested again. Out of the 4 or 5 research articles I've looked at, I haven't seen any other new articles. So that would be something that, if you know of another article, I have a contact page, and let me know. So here's one, Swain et al., where we have a white peeled potato, and it says that there's zero salicylates per kilogram. The reason I put these little notes in is because here we have a white unpeeled potato, and Swain tested it at quite low, 1.2 milligrams. But when Malachar retested it, they tested at 4.64. But the reason why this matters is because Malachar doesn't specify if it's peeled or not. and that there's at least some variation, if not the varieties have changed over 35 years. Another type of research that is very valuable is clinical practice or practitioner practice. And I have a book here, the ARPA Elimination Diet Handbook. There's another one, Karen Fisher. She is a nutritionist in Canada who works with skin disorders like eczema. These doctors, nutritionists, practitioners are working directly with patients. They say, hey, try this low-salicylate list. They might have one published for their clinic. They might have a pamphlet. They say, try this. And then the patient might come back and say, you know, I reacted to the lemon and lime that was on the low list. And so what they might do is remove and update their list, take the lemon and lime out if they get so many patients reacting to it all the time, move it off, move it up to a higher category and say, maybe you shouldn't. A lot of people react to that. And they modify their lists that way. Another way that information is compiled and lists are made is by researchers. Now, I'm a researcher. I like going through, finding the research articles, saying, you know, we talk about this, but do we really have any scientific evidence to support that? There are a couple of really great researchers. Sharla Race, who wrote the Salicylate Handbook, she is a great researcher. I love looking through her her reference lists on every single chapter. She lists her sources. I do go through and read all of these. I'm also trying to update my website research page so that you guys can easily find research articles. Sharla is a woman who lives in England, I believe, and she also has salicylate sensitivity. She has it very severely. This book is basically her story about how she found out about it, how she ends up managing it, and she also includes lists. She does have situations where she might say, you know, I've heard lavender is a high, lavender essential oil is a high salicylate, but I don't react to it. And so she puts her information on here. Like she can handle a little tiny bit of lime without an issue. The last type of list, and this is just a culmination and it just happens because some lists are easier than others to read. Of course, I'm going to say it, the Google results. We're gonna look at some lists and analyze and critique them. So nicely, sometimes you will find variation in lists because the information is just flat out wrong. The information is wrong. Like maybe somebody who isn't very intimately knowledgeable about the subject decided to make a website and accidentally put essential oils in the low category because they didn't understand that those are actually very high. I like to think that people didn't do it maliciously and that it was probably an accident. And it just happens. Sometimes there's bad information or fake information. And we have to be diligent and vigilant to find good and correct information when on the internet. The second thing that happens on the internet is that there's outdated information. Now, I build websites all the time. I don't do websites full-time for a living, but it is incorporated into my paid real job. And I also do substantial work for a nonprofit native plant society. There it is with the plants again. I work on their website, and that is a really big task. Now, there's something about owning websites and producing information, whether it's in print or on websites, and it is that you should have updated information. If you're not willing to go back to and update it or manage it, you should at least put a date on it so that people know how old that resource is. Another source of variation is that we are connecting globally online, and countries handle illness and medical issues and research differently. And that's just something that we have to get used to. So most of the research for salicylate sensitivity comes out of Australia. And other countries like the UK, Norway, Germany, Canada do support it to some extent. And in other countries, like the one I'm in, people look at you like you have four eyes and that you're making things up. And so it's really challenging, depending on which country you live in, you know, how illness is treated. So, yeah, I thought about moving countries so that I'd have some medical support, but it's just not feasible. I decided to move out to the country instead. Just get away from people and fragrances and try and grow my own food and find my own, you know, sources of meat and dairy and things like that so that I can be the healthiest I can be. More reasons for variation is that these lists, especially these two research articles, right? One was done in 1985 and one was done in 2017. Now, I haven't thoroughly looked at, and I will, and someday when I really wrap my head around how these were processed, I will compare the processes of how they extracted the salicylic acid. But there's just a huge time gap, right? I think the earliest study was done in the late 70s, and there are, like I said, several other studies. On my food list, I have these other studies here. Robertson and Kermode, 1981, was an important study. Venema et al., 1996, and Wood et al., 2011. Those are also really important articles that tested spices and different foods, and also either a lot of them do support Swain et al.'s 1985 studies. So just think about that. There's a large amount of time that's passed between these studies, and possibly the methods that they used were also changed or may have varied. So now we've talked about the variation in the lists and how those were compiled, but let's talk about variation in food, which is really important and really what we care about. The reason we want to know which lists we can eat is because we want to know which foods we can eat. Like, it'd be so nice to add another food to our diet. Wouldn't that be great? And not, you know, completely kill our weekend if we test on Friday. You know, we want to feel better. And so this is the reason why we really care. One thing that we don't know in these studies is which variety was tested. Some of these items, let's see. Some of them, like plums, were in Swain, they tested like six different plums, right? And so it was helpful that they included the varieties. White potato, I'm gonna guess that's russet because that's what I have in my neighborhood. So I've seen lists where it says lettuce and you're like, well, it should be iceberg lettuce. But did you know that there's a whole bunch of different varieties of iceberg lettuce? Like, which variety did they test? The next thing is, you're gonna put your botany hats on, is that there's variation within a species. So what that means is that, we'll look at humans because we're, you know, we'll pull it away from plants, which can be very complicated sometimes. But basically, there is a gene pool where all the humans have variety. There's variation in hair color. We have all the way from, you know, blonde to reds and browns and blacks and hair color, texture, and everything, right? We can see that. That makes sense to us. A human being has a lot of different shapes and colors and textures. So if you can imagine that, when we're talking about a plant, that there might be some plants in the species that produce a little bit of salicylic acid and some plants in the species that produce a lot of it. That's not hard for us to grasp. One of the things we don't talk about with plants is that we don't really anthropomorphize them, meaning that we don't animate them or give them feelings or make them feel like they're human, right? There's SpongeBob, but he was a sponge, and you know, there's Larry the cucumber and his tomato friend, right? We do sometimes, but for the most part, we make cartoons out of animals and we say that animals feel sad. And the reason why I bring this up is because plants, what we don't think about is that plants are very responsive to stimulus. In the case of herbivory, which means that a plant gets chewed on, it will respond to it. Now, there I haven't found any articles specifically related to salicylates, but as far as plant chemicals go, an animal will come up to a plant, and let's say the plant has a low level of chemicals, it'll get nibbled on, and then the plant will respond and produce more defense chemicals. And so when that animal comes back maybe the next day, or his friends come back for a snack, that plant will have produced more defensive chemicals to say, hey, don't eat me. It's not unusual or weird to think that salicylates could potentially change also for a plant within a day or, you know, a couple of hours. One of the other things to consider is the ripeness. So how fresh is a food? When does the salicylates peak? RPOP handbook has a really cool little diagram that basically says the less ripe a food is, the higher the salicylate, and the more ripe they are, the fewer salicylates are in them. So I think I'm gonna pause there. We've talked about why is there so much variation in lists, and I don't want this video to be like the last one, which was way too long. Of course, that was my story, so I can make it as long as I want, but I do want these to be reasonable little snippets for you. Part two of this list question will be me analyzing other people's lists that they've provided online and what I think about that, and why you shouldn't just believe everything that you find online. And so we're just gonna review them. You can check out my article that I wrote. It's lowsallife.com/blog, and there will be an article there, and you can get a sneak peek before I publish the second part. Anyway, let me know what you think, and if you have any questions, leave them in the comments. If you yourself have tried foods on the low list and have reacted to them and have wondered why, and you just had your aha moment today, please let me know. That's the reason why I'm doing this. I want people to be happy and healthy and to have the best resources available. I think that's all for right now. We'll see you in part two, where we roast some websites. Have a great day. Bye.